part two of the trilogy preeclampsia. Part two, we will deal with the treatment of preeclampsia, the very interesting and intriguing pathogenesis as far as we know, and we will finish with a number of conclusions. The treatment, it's very embarrassing. In fact, we don't have a proper treatment. The only approach is quite simple. Chase the baby out. So deliver the baby either through inductional labor or do a cesarean section in case of severe preeclampsia. In case of mild preeclampsia, you might just be approached the watchful waiting approach. So it's somewhat obstetrical embarrassing. We are unable to modify preeclampsia. Hence, delivery is the, between quotation marks, treatment. Watchful waiting in case of mild preeclampsia, so in absence of symptoms or organ damage pointing at severe preeclampsia, the main aim is that we prevent complications in case of severe preeclampsia. Then the delivery, if the delivery is the default, the main challenge will be at what gestational age should we deliver the baby? And we will discuss that looking at two very impressive randomized clinical trials, the HIPPITET trial 1 and 2. Preeclampsia organ damage, such as liver function damage or kidney damage or eclamptic fit, is usually reversible, and the exception to this is the cerebral bleeding, which can have lifelong consequences or even can result in maternal death. Mild preeclampsia or hypertension after 37 weeks of gestation, what is the best approach? Should we induce labor or should we wait? The HIPPITET 1 randomized clinical trial by Koopmans et al., as published in The Lancet in 2009, gives us a clear insight in this question. Here we look at maternal outcomes, a beautiful randomized clinical trial with 377 women in the induction of labor group, and 379 women where expectant management was offered, so monitoring the blood pressure and check. The composite of adverse maternal outcomes was for 31% in the induction of labor group present and for a 44% in the expectant monitoring group. So that difference, the relative risk was 0.71, which means a 29% relative risk reduction, and that's significant. So if you look now at all the underlying criteria for the mother, the severe cephalic systolic hypertension was the case in 15% versus 23%, significant, and the severe hypertension diastolically, the same differences were seen. Severe proteinuria, HELLP syndrome or eclampsia, however, were not significant, as were maternal death. So it's mainly the severe hypertension which made the difference in outcomes. So induction of labor would reduce the likelihood of the mothers to progress towards severe hypertension systolically and diastolically. For the neonate, there was no difference in outcomes after 37 weeks. Let's now move to the HIPPITET trial 2, which was published in The Lancet in 2015. In both were published in very prestigious journals. Very well done of this group of Dutchies. If a woman presents with preeclampsia between 34 and 37 weeks, we ask ourselves the same question. Should we in principle aim for delivery or should we in principle offer expectant management, vigilant management and wait and see? Again, a beautiful randomized clinical trial with close to 350 patients in both groups. The first group was offered immediate delivery, that means induction of labor, and the other group was offered expectant management. For the primary maternal outcomes, the combination of a few parameters, we can see here that the relative risk was 0.39, but that crosses the one line, so that was not a significant difference whether you would wait and see or offer immediate delivery. Here we see the different parameters which represented that primary outcome, and we can see here thromboembolism, pulmonary edema, HELLP syndrome, eclampsia, placental abruption or death, no significant differences in both groups. Okay, neonatal outcomes, and that's important. If you would decide to deliver the baby prematurely via an induction of labor or cesarean section even, we can see that the respiratory distress syndrome in the immediate delivery group is 5.7% versus only 1.7% in the expectant monitoring group. And the relative risk is 3.3, which is highly significant. So while induction of labor had no significant benefit for the mother, it had significant disadvantages for the neonate. It's important that these differences were not life-threatening for the neonate, but still, the conclusion, if it were true, would be it's better to wait unless we have signs of severe preeclampsia. Let's now move to the topic severe hypertension. As defined by a systolic blood pressure of more than 160, a diastolic blood pressure of more than 110 millimeters mercury. Here it's important that we actively and even aggressively bring that blood pressure down to prevent the potential fatal cerebral bleeding. So if you're in a hospital setting, IV labetalol or hydralazine are the drugs of choice. If no IV access is available, oral nifedipine should be started as soon as possible. Here we can see a schedule for labetalol and nifedipine, which I let's say 20 to 50 milligrams IV boluses over 2 minutes. You can repeat it every 15 to 30 minutes until the blood pressure comes back to the normal range. And I think we would be accepting here a blood pressure just under 140 and 140-90. Nifedipine tablets, 10 milligrams or 20 milligrams oral, which would also have a blood pressure lower effect. In case of severe hypertension, we should not only give drugs to lower the maternal blood pressure, but we should administer slowly IV 4 grams of magnesium sulfate intravenously, and if no IV access is available, such in third world countries, we could give the same drug intramuscularly. By the way, injections are quite painful, but they are very useful to prevent an eclamptic fit, which has severe complications for the mother if not treated promptly. Okay, what about the pathogenesis of preeclampsia? This is a diagram I took from a publication of Lam et al. In hypertension in 2005. Here we see the situation in the normal early presentation. Okay, what do we see here on the right-hand side? This part of the picture represents the myometrium. On the left-hand side, the placenta, the primitive placenta, and here we see the interface. What is happening in normal placentation, we can see here, this blood vessel represents the spiral artery, and we see here from the placenta, cytotrophoblasts invading and covering the maternal spiral arteries. If this process takes place in a normal way, there is deep invasion of the cytotrophoblasts into the spiral arteries, and that results in a wide blood vessel which has a high caliber vessel, so it allows a generous flow of blood from the mother into the intervillous space. That's an essential part of a normal placentation. We look now at the panel on the right-hand side, where we can see the spiral artery. The cytotrophoblast invasion has been more, is more superficially, is more shallow, and in fact that results at less, yeah, we call it a defective uteroplacental circulation. Whilst that has no symptoms initially, did form the foundation for preeclampsia, especially later in pregnancy. So it's the early placentation which lays the foundation for an uneventful pregnancy without hypertension and other system disorders or preeclampsia. This is one of the important things to take on board. There are other factors at play. When we look now at a blood vessel, this is here a normal blood vessel. The blue cells represent the endothelium, and the endothelium here in a healthy situation has placental growth factor, the brown protein which can, where a vascular endothelial growth factor can attach to, or other factors. And in principle, if this process takes place in a healthy placenta, the blood vessel will stay, the endothelium will stay healthy, and the blood vessel will stay wide, and so the anticoagulant and vasodilatory factors will be the predominant theme. In case of preeclampsia, we have the opposite. We see more the tendency to clotting, to procoagulation, and vasoconstriction. So when we look at the endothelial and the endothelium, there are different factors at play as well when we compare a healthy placenta and a placenta in case of preeclampsia. Here's another diagram which shows the shallow implantation and placental ischemia as we discussed before. On one hand, we have maternal endothelial cell damage with pro-inflammation taking place, nitrous oxygen reduced, which is a powerful vasodilation. And on the other hand, we have here platelet aggregation, which results in lowering of the and increasing of the thrombin. These mechanisms both result in systemic vasoconstriction, vasospasm, which reduce blood flow to various organs and intravascular coagulation. If you would summarize these mechanisms, and of course what I describe here is a simplification, we have a number of immune factors playing a role, natural killer cells, genetic factors, very important, chronic oxidative stress, which is especially plays a role in obese women, poor nutrition, and other factors. The superficial ingrowth of the citotrophoblasts into the spiral arteries, as we discussed, that results on one hand to fetal growth restriction, but on the other hand, we can see placental dysfunction, and that can result in various areas, hypertension on one hand, proteinuria, renal system involvement, liver involvement, and cerebral edema and vasospasm as well. And you can see here, anti-angiogenic factors are released, which an anti- and inflammatory mediators are released, which play a role in the organ damage, as we discussed before. It's intriguing, despite thousands of studies and publications about the pathogenesis of preeclampsia, it's still not yet fully understood. And yeah, maybe we were looking for one underlying mechanism, but it's very feasible that maybe preeclampsia, where there's more renal involvement with proteinuria, might have a slightly different mechanism compared to preeclampsia, as we see in HELLP syndrome or in IAGR. The conclusions of preeclampsia. It's a heterogeneous presentation. There is no reliable standout symptoms. The pathogenesis is not fully understood. So for all this, the doctors to be, I think that's an opportunity for you guys to come up with the right answer and go to Stockholm one day to receive the Nobel Prize. Multisystem disorder, that's the modern definition, beyond the high blood pressure and proteinuria. So it's hypertension after 20 weeks of pregnancy, blood pressure more than 140 and 90, and kidney disorder as expressed by proteinuria or increased serum creatinine level, or involvement of the hematological system, as particularly the platelets, which drop in combination with liver function damage, as we can find if the ALT and the AST are increased, or central nervous system involvement, and or involvement of the placenta and the fetus when there is IUGR. If there is uncomplicated preeclampsia suspected based on blood pressure or symptoms, check deep tendon reflexes and check serum creatinine, platelets, ALT, AST, and the urine protein creatinine index. That will allow you to take stock of if there's organ damage taking place at an early stage. This will help you to confirm or refute the diagnosis preeclampsia. Preeclampsia does not cure itself. To the contrary, it tends to progress, as we have seen in the HIPITAT 1 study. There is no real antenatal treatment available other than, you know, deliver the baby and the placenta. So in general, if there is a gestational age of more than 37 weeks, we should aim for induction of labor. If severe and or early preeclampsia or HELLP syndrome, then induction of labor is probably important to prevent severe complications in the mother, and we accept the risk of the baby. Of course, ideally, we like to administer corticosteroids 48 and 24 hours before the planned delivery. But however, in absence of symptoms of severity between 34 and 37 weeks, expected management appears to be the best way forward. Important that we have these beautiful randomized clinical trials, but these trials should not be abused, I should say, by binary thinking that we should always wait after when we are dealing with 34 to 34 weeks, or that we should always induce labor after 37 weeks. You always should look at the individual woman and apply common sense. So evidence-based medicine, ENT. An early diagnosis is important to prevent worse for mother and fetus. We see now around the world, very good initiatives that every pregnant woman should have a regular blood pressure check. I think also, for instance, the Bill and Melinda Gates initiative is checking that we have blood pressure measurement devices available all around the world, which should reduce maternal complications and death, especially in the third world. If you would be interested in extra reading, sure, I have to warn you, just in PubMed, preeclampsia, my goodness, 30,575 publications, so you might be busy for a little while. This is in contrast to Jimmy. Jimmy, our Zen master in chief, appears to be unimpressed by blood pressure and its complications and preeclampsia. He is pretty relaxed about it. We should not be. This concludes preeclampsia part 2. I hope you found this interesting. And of course, in part 3, you will be able, based on six different case scenarios, to apply the knowledge acquired in preeclampsia part 1 and 2. I hope to see you soon for part 3. Thank you.